We will open it up for the board members to discuss, but I do want to clarify one thing, because I personally spoke to Dr. Dorland with Jefferson County, and then of course Stephanie Schooley, the board president, and very clearly both of them said that they did not want the mask mandate removed before the 11th of February. That's really important that their message gets out there properly. They said they could be ready by then, but please not to do it before. And they also said they would want it all done at the same time with the public mask order as well as the school mask order. So it was all treated the same. So just wanted to make sure that was clarified. I personally did speak to them. Okay, board members, time for discussion. Who would like to go first? Questions?
I'll offer my thoughts. This has been such a traumatic 2 years for everyone, and it is very exciting to finally see trends going so favorably, but we're still so far above where we were when we started having masks. It does feel premature to me still. I do want us to have an end date, but I don't want to arbitrarily just pick one. So it does still feel premature to remove the mask mandates today.
Further comments? Harriet, I don't see you. Do you have a comment, or Kimberly?
I do have a
comment. There you are. I thought that was you.
I am here.
And we're happy to have you, Harriet. We just want everyone to know she's just had surgery, so we're treating her kindly. Thank you for taking time to sign on, Harriet.
Well, and that would be why mostly my video is off, because you don't need to watch me. But I do want to make a comment. And it's not going to be a conclusive comment yet, because I want to hear the rest of the discussion. I am incredibly torn by this decision. I listened to our first few commenters and our last commenter, and was sad that we haven't heard more of that input over the course of the months. It feels like the whole situation in the county, in terms of our concern for our citizens, has gotten polarized, which should not be the case. And that somehow you need to sign up with, I support the older people who are afraid to go out, which is one that it's easy for me to understand, because that's the situation I'm in, you know, or I really support the family members who are struggling with the masking of their children, and the barriers that they feel that puts in place to their learning. Those are both very valid perspectives. We've heard a lot from one and very little from the other. And I was pleased to hear some of the other perspective today. But it's why I'm torn, you know, because I think that Lane has a really good point. We are not yet to the points where we said we would be lifting the mandate. And yet here we are, very close to doing that. I think that part of what I'm struggling with is that COVID is not the only aspect of public health. And there are many other things that have to be considered in this decision, and that are what I'm weighing in the next few minutes before I have to decide how I'm going to vote on this issue. Because things like the employment of people in the community have to do with their public health. Things like the education of our kids, our workforce, and the fact that our workforces are not feeling supported. All of those things have to do with public health, and our responsibility as public health board members is that broad. It is not just managing the COVID epidemic. On the other hand, the COVID epidemic is a large enough issue, the pandemic, it's a large enough issue that it can really interfere with the rest of the issues that are important to public health. So I just wanted to say that now, and then I'm going to turn my camera off and unmute and remute and listen to some more discussion, and you'll probably hear from me again, but I really am torn.
Kimberly.
Thank you. I am also torn as a citizen of this county, as a healthcare provider in this county. I have done a lot of thinking and a lot of listening and a lot of reading. And it was suggested this week in an email that I got from somebody that my decisions are based on my ego. And I want to address that. That's the furthest thing from the truth, that I am making decisions because of my ego. I also was encouraged to be brave in another letter, brave to make a decision that might not be popular. Well, that's really tough, because if one votes yes, then the individuals who have really provided very valid reasoning for their discomfort, for their fear, and I don't judge that fear at all, for their concern. I have received many letters from individuals, teachers, and principals within the school district who are asking me to keep this order in place because of their concern that the school district right now, the schools are not in the best place to transition, so that kids who have the blessing of being healthy can go to school with their classmates who aren't blessed with that health, who are being treated by cancer, cystic fibrosis, those kinds of things. And so what this has really brought me to was an understanding that there has to be some compromise. There can't be a black or a white in this. We all have to compromise. Now, if I listen to the parents who have a very strong voice that the kids who are masked are hurting and are being traumatized, that's important to hear. But for me, it's as important to hear the gentleman who spoke, who kicked off our public comment, that elders who have been isolated, who need to go grocery shopping, who need to go to their doctors, and who need to have public transportation or another person take them, they need that same consideration. I agree with Lane. We are very optimistic and encouraged by the data that has been presented. I love seeing the line come straight down, but I'm also very cautious about this. And I am left asking myself, when is it time to give the entire responsibility to the individual who's making decisions for themselves in a pandemic? When we put the health orders in place in November, where we set the goalpost of the 21 days in the CDC moderate level, I believe that was the right thing to do. And I look at a positivity rate still of 15% in this county, and that concerns me. So I'm on the fence as well. And I have a very strong belief that the work that the Jefferson County Public Health Department has done to date, the encouragement of vaccines, the requests for masks and social distancing, those are things I believe have slowed the transmission and helped in keeping our county safe. So I'd like to hear, Sherry, from you as well. But before I do that, I want to tell you that I also have spoken with school board members and understanding their concern about the medically, the kids who are at medical risk and the desire to have the schools given the time they need to be ready for kids to return to school with the choice to be masked. So with that, I'll share, turn over to you, Sherry.
Thank you, Kimberly. You know, I mean, it is a tough one. Nobody's going to deny that. You have, either way you go, someone's not going to be happy. And so when I look at the picture, you know, I understand that everybody comes into this with their own little niche, if you will. You know, some people are really focused on hospitalizations. Some people are really focused on the economic, you know, business side and the mental health side and the preschools or the K-12s. I look at it as the community as a whole, because all of those things come into play when you're talking about community. So I've tried to educate myself on all of those pieces and then come to something that what is reasonable. And Kimberly, I think you chose a really good word. You know, you say, you use the word compromise. Is there ever going to be a perfect time? We don't know. Could something come up again down the road? Of course it could. But can we continue with everything in our favor right now and probably at the best time it's going to be, you know, for a while, to talk about removing the mask mandate, because everything is coming down. Everything is going in the right direction. Let's say that. And so what do we do when we look at the whole piece? One of the pieces that I've spent a lot of time looking at is the mental health, because that is incredibly important to me. You know, I have worked with people and I continue to work with people and stay in touch with people who have really struggled through this. It has been extremely tough on our communities. And people, you know, I had some emails come in too saying, you know, don't, you know, pander to the ones that are just weary. Well, you know what? Everybody's weary. I think that everybody is feeling extremely exhausted. They're exhausted over this. And so when is a good time to say, you know what, right now, where do we move forward? How do we become sustainable? And at the same time, Kimberly, I think you said something else that was really important. At the same time, when do each of us become responsible for keeping ourselves safe? I have to tell you, I'm a mask wearer. I know that'll shock some of the people out there, but I wear a mask all the time. And I probably will continue because that's my choice. I can do that. And I think it's wrong if people, you know, belittle someone for that. But it's my choice to do that. At what point do we say, it's time for me to keep my family safe? You know, it's time for us to look at it as something that, and I've tried to understand more and more as we move to become sustainable into an endemic. Because we cannot, as a community, as a whole, with the hospitals, the schools, the businesses, the mental health issues, we cannot continue the same path for a long period of time, a lot longer, because you can already see people are so weary. They have every right to be. I'm not going to belittle them for that. Everybody deals with things differently, you know? But I do look at the mental health, and I believe that people are ready to say, can I take it on myself? You know, when is the time for me to be able to do my job? And so that's really important to me. The other thing that's important to me is, you know, you all know I own a small business and I have a lot of peers and we keep in touch. And it has devastated some of them to the point of attempted suicide because they lost their business. They could no longer provide for their family. And it's taking a toll on the community. So when we weigh everything out, we have to look at the whole piece. Our mental health systems and our providers are overwhelmed. The highest percentages that we've ever seen with people seeking help because they're maxed out. So at what point do we say, you know what, it's time to give it a try? I mean, the numbers are in our favor right now. Does that mean we could never go back if something happens? No. But, you know, right now, I have to look at it and say, we got to give this a chance. And when you have the school saying that we're having a hard time with some of our vulnerable populations, you know, when I was talking to the superintendent, when they're talking about having a hard time with, you know, working with the early literacy programs and the English language learners and the speech therapy kids that are in the speech therapy and, you know, the younger kids. And I mean, I have to take that into consideration. So whichever direction you go, someone's not going to be happy. But I think it's time to step out and say, we got to give this a try. We got to remove this mandate and see where we go. And let people be responsible for themselves.
Thank you. I also listened with earnest to the woman who spoke about, you know, being in a fitness center and individuals not renewing their membership or feeling comfortable coming into back into the gyms to participate in exercise, and hearing those comments from our business owners concerns me deeply. I've been asked, well, have you talked to anybody who doesn't support your position? Well, yeah, because my position is at this time is 50-50. I have listened to people who have shared with me their struggles with this mask and who feel the best thing to do right now is to remove it. One of the struggles that I'm having is, what do I do then with the 15% positivity rate with a variant that's highly transmissible, albeit not resulting in death, or hopefully, you know, the hospitalization rates going down as well. But a week into this showing the drop, I want to believe that the trajectory of that drop is going to be the same as what the drop was at this time last year in the graph that Christine showed. And there's a cautiousness in me that is why what Lane says resonates with me. I'm not saying let's keep the mask date on indefinitely. I have no action to do that. But lifting it today, as Christy and some of those other people were saying, if it got approved overnight, it can be released overnight. Do I feel comfortable with making that for today at 2:30, whatever time it is? I don't think so. But I do understand that perhaps a compromise that leads to us all being safe. I don't know where the idea came that we were going to let the adults have mask freedom and we were going to keep the kids masked. I don't know where that came from, but I did not promote that. Can we wait even, you know, till the 11th? Like was requested, or the 15th. I know, Lane, you don't want to put an arbitrary date on it, but is that part of the compromise we can talk about? Or are we, you know, are we so set to wait until what Mr. McDonald shared at the beginning, of the guidance that we put in the 21 days in the moderate? I don't know. So I'm just asking that of Harriet and Lane and Sherry.
No, I want to respond really quickly. And because something you, I just spent so much time like you and Lane and Harriet reading and listening and studying. One of the groups that I followed was the Colorado COVID-19 Modeling Group, which is the university researchers. And they have estimated that roughly 2/3 of the state will have been infected by Omicron by the end of February. This includes those that are unvaccinated. And that's huge. So this combined with protection vaccines and boosters, the researchers believe, they believe this, that 80% of the state will be immune by mid-February. And I think Dr. Comstock and Christine, both of you had gone over those numbers. According to the COVID-19 modeling group's latest report, even if the control measures are dramatically reduced now, the COVID cases and hospitalizations will continue to fall because of the trajectory that it's on. So that was important to me. And then I think one of the other things that was important to me that you mentioned, and I'm not saying that we should be copycats and follow whatever, but one of the things that was really important, if I remember correctly, when we put this mandate in place, was that we worked as a region. And that was a really big deal then. And we now have Tri-County removed the mask mandate January 31st. Denver's ending it today. They're allowing it to expire. Broomfield is allowing theirs to expire today. Larimer County will end the mask mandate February 12th. And the counties and stuff around us, our partners, have said, you know what, it's time. It's time for us to see, you know, what we can do by all being responsible. Yes. I think that we should continue to strongly encourage the masking and vaccines, but I think it should be a strongly encourage. I just think that if we're going to work together as a region, I don't know how Jefferson County, one of the largest counties, how do you then, if Jefferson County does not do this and all the counties around it do, I think we're in serious trouble. Because, you know, Denver is just on the other side of Jefferson County. Well, people will go over there and shop. Okay, well, then they'll come back over here. They work over there, and then they'll come back over here. The same with Broomfield, the same with, you know, the Tri-County, Adams County, et cetera, et cetera. We're not an island of our own in Jefferson County. We touch all of this, and we are partners. And again, I'm adamant that, you know, some people want us to end it today. Well, I will tell you straight up front that I will respect what the schools have asked, because I think that's a really big deal. They have medically fragile kids, and they have kids that they need to make sure that, and like Dr. Dorland said, they have air systems they need to make sure are all implemented and in place so that they can offer the highest protections. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. We were so important that we be a region and continue to work together. And I believe that is also important, especially when you're talking about businesses. You know, they cross lines all the time. Their employees cross lines all the time. So. Oh, there's Harriet. She's waving at me. There you go, Harriet. Please go ahead and unmute yourself.
Unmute. I had to switch to my phone because my iPad was running out of juice, even though I had it plugged in. So I apologize for how. Anyhow, and I don't know where the mute button is now on the phone, but I've got it unmuted. So there are. I'm still torn. But in the course of the discussion, I have thought of two things that I have not thought of, that I have thought of before, but haven't said yet today, that make me a little more comfortable if we do end up ending the mask mandate. The first one is the change in what we know about masking, which is that N95 masks, and I suspect we will end up with a even larger group of masks that have been tested and that are shown truly to protect. A year ago when we said, well, it's up to the person, and if they want to wear a mask, they can wear a mask, and if they don't want to wear a mask, they don't wear a mask, it didn't make any sense, because wearing a mask a year ago, most everyone was wearing cloth masks. There weren't N95s around, and the cloth masks helped to protect other people. So the reason for wearing a mask was to protect others, but you weren't protecting yourself when you wore a mask. You were protecting others. Now we can actually protect ourselves when we wear a mask. And so for the elderly people who are afraid to grocery shop, if we can get the information out to them about the protection that now is afforded and the availability of those masks, then there is, then the message about personal responsibility starts to make more sense than it did a year ago. So that's one piece. That message needs to come from a trusted source. And that trusted source should be us at the health department. Unfortunately, the polarization that I talked about before, I think, has eroded a significant amount of that trust. So the one piece of this discussion or this issue that I'm bringing up that worries me is, so will, if we end the mandate, is that going to increase the trust or decrease the trust? Because I think that increasing the trust in the health department as a source of information that people can believe becomes really important. And it's really important in that factor. In terms of understanding that, yes, there are masks that make a difference and folks could use them. Same thing with vaccination. The data about vaccination and the effectiveness of vaccination, it's such a shame that that became polarized. The other issue that I have been struggling with is what does it mean to shift from being a pandemic to being endemic? I've been reading on that, and I read an excellent article a couple of days ago in The Atlantic, which has some really good scientific stuff, even though it's not a scientific journal, that pointed out that even when we are in endemic stages, in terms of if you look at other diseases that have gone endemic, first of all, they're very different. The whole endemicity, if that's how you pronounce it, is really different but depending on the disease. And we don't know what it's going to be like for COVID because it's not the same as any other disease. But many of the diseases that are endemic still have periods of time in areas where they become basically at heavy duty proportions and need responses. And should we in that phase of the endemic come to a point where we need to put a mask order back on or put some other order back in place, that trust piece that I was talking about becomes really important. Or we're going to end up with the same kind of people like one of the speakers who basically said, I don't care about this because I don't wear a mask anyhow. The people who do not respect the health department orders is a real concern, and how many of them we have. So that's two more pieces that I'm weighing. I'm still in the process of figuring all of this out. So thanks, Sherry.
Further comments? You know, one of the things that I'm trying to learn more about, you know, this board had a very busy week. I want everyone to know that everybody worked very, very hard on trying to learn as much as we could this week, reaching out to community people and our partners and stuff. So we were all very, very busy with our regular jobs, but we were very busy doing our work, trying to get answers so that we could come educated. One of the things that I do want to know more about, but I'm very, very encouraged by with what I was reading, are some of the pharmaceuticals that are going to now be available and that seem to be, you know, coming forward, where there's actually, you know, treatments that we'll be able to do. And the other thing, and I keep, my brain keeps going back to this, is as we were dealing with all of this in November, we were dealing with Delta. It was not, you know, it was the downright hard, you know, COVID. It was not the Omicron. Now the Omicron, yes, was more contagious, but at the same time, and Kimberly, I think you kind of mentioned this, the positivity rate is still at 15%, but these are not the cases that are going to the, you know, ICUs. They're not the ones going to the hospitalizations. Yeah, people are getting sick. My daughter, my son-in-law, who both have double vaccinated and boosted, they did get sick, but because they had gone to the, you know, of getting the vaccines and boosters, it was, oh my God, for like 24 to 36 hours. And then that was, you know, that was it. They weren't going into the hospital. So I understand the positivity rate is like, oh my, holy Toledo, except that it's not like it was when it was Delta. It's a different now. And as far as future, I've thought about that too, Harriet. Future, what does that bring? Well, boy, if we had all the answers to the different things of future in the world today, we could just make the world anything that we wanted it to be, right? We'll never know the future. We have no idea. We can only deal with what we have today and the information that we have today. Yes, you can project, but how far? We don't know what this is going to do. We have no idea of knowing that. Kimberly?
So many, there you go. So many places to unmute. As I've listened to all of this additional conversation, again, what keeps coming up to me is compromise. And I think that the Board of Health is asking, being asked to compromise, right? Through our discussion and our vote, how do we make a decision regarding this health order? And I think that compromise must extend to our community. There has to be some compromise on all of our parts in order to move from a pandemic to an endemic. Because in speaking with a couple of individuals who are really opposed to the mask order and the vaccine and whatever, there's this kind of unspoken thought that we're going to go from what we have been going through for the last 2 years immediately back to where we were in 2017 and 2018. And shifting from a pandemic into an endemic does require plans. It requires patience. It requires compromise. And it does require some very specific things that I think the health department has been and is in progress of communicating those things. So when I think about the individuals who spoke today, who expressed concern about businesses and the gyms and the schools, in compromise, would businesses, if we lifted the mask on the 11th or whatever, would businesses who even have struggled with the mask mandate be willing to compromise to have specific shopping times, a half a day or a day, for individuals like the woman who shared that she brought her mother here from Texas and that she wants to know that she, to the best of her knowledge, she's not bringing COVID home to her family. Would the gyms be willing to compromise so that individuals who didn't rejoin the gym, not because they were being asked to wear masks, but because they didn't maybe particularly feel as comfortable exercising in that environment without them or without some other mitigation things, would nursing homes and hospices be willing to compromise that families could visit their loved ones if they wore a mask in to see them? These are just a couple of thoughts that have been going through my mind of, for me, the only successful way forward is compromising. Harriet, I love the point you bring up about restoration of trust in the health department. That's what they're tasked with. And maybe it isn't even a pandemic. Maybe it's something else, something environmental or all the other things that are being accomplished and worked on through the health department, that we need the community's help in keeping our county safe. How do we reestablish that? And I believe the answer is through compromise. So that's what I think.
So when you talk about compromise, I mean, I've given this a lot of thought too. Because it is, I mean, nobody's going to get everything that they want. I learned that a long time ago. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you get a piece of the pie, not the whole pie. In my mind, things will be quite even advanced watching the numbers, listening to the reports that come in. Today is the very beginning of February. But even by the middle, from the reports that I've read and from some of these research groups, by the middle of February, things are, they're moving in the right direction. I would, like I said before, respect, number one, our schools, because they're very, very important, and they have our children, and they do have a lot of different, with the medically fragile, et cetera, that we've already talked about. And so I wouldn't want to do it any sooner than the 11th of February, because I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that to the schools. I want to do it with the community, not to the community. And I think it's important that we work with community. And everybody's going to have to compromise. We're never going to all be on the same page. That's just my thought. Other thoughts? We're getting close to 3. Come on, y'all. I know we can do this.
All right. So, in a spirit of compromise, may I try a motion for discussion? And to move things along. And my motion would be that we end the mask mandates on the 18th, which gives us one more week to ensure that the trends continue, and that there be a included in the motion that the that we will have another special meeting in a week should there be any changes in that data. And I'm just going to throw that out for discussion. And I do hope that people feel quite free to amend it.
I'll just put her motion.
Harriet, would you be, sorry, you just turned your phone back on.
Oh, I'm still here. I just was turning the picture off, but I'm here.
Okay. Are we, Kimberly, did you write that? Did you write it down as, and put it into a motion as Harriet was saying so that
yes,
Harriet could actually
I
make
did.
A motion?
Yes. Do you want me to read with the motion that Harriet
provided? Yes, please.
Okay. I was writing as fast as I could, Harriet. Okay. So the motion that Harriet brings to the for discussion is to end the mandate, all mask mandates effective on February 18th. Included within this motion is the request for a special Board of Health meeting 1 week from today to look at the data to understand if anything significant has changed. I hope I got that right, Harriet.
Actually, I was wavering between the special meeting or calling the special meeting if anything has changed, but I think the way you got it is probably the clearest way to do it, so we should do it that way.
Well, wait a minute, I have a question because we're open for discussion because there was a second, right? Lane, you seconded it? Okay, so we're in discussion. Okay, my question is, if there is a change, is that what you're saying? So that the board would be able to call a special session to discuss any changes if there was a change, is that what you're saying?
Right, and basically what I'm saying is if there was a change that made us not confident that the trends were continuing, that we would have a special meeting so we would be able to reverse course. So we have, you know, we basically have another week of data before this is really final. But we're making the decision now with a date because so many people have asked for a date, and I think that makes difference for people.
Tell me, just out of curiosity, I'm not challenging you or questioning you.
Yeah.
just me out of too. Curiosity, just saying. Where did the 18th come from? Is there a specific reason that you chose the 18th?
Yes, it's 1 week after the 11th. And I do know that the schools initially started requesting the 11th as a date about a week ago. So it basically gives them the same notice that they were asking for a week ago when the 11th kind of got in all of our minds as a potential date. But mainly because it's one more week, gives us one more week of data and still time to make a decision.
And Harriet, this is Kimberly. Do you feel strongly that additional week, and Lane also, until the 18th is necessary?
Would you consider the 11th? Or the 15th? The 15th. Can we compromise at the 15th?
I made it in the spirit of compromise, looking at where all four of us are, as well as the various perspectives that we have heard. So I would have to decide if it was a different date, I would have to decide where I was at on that date.
Okay. Lane, I know that you had voiced concern about picking an arbitrary date. The date of the 11th, I also want to respect what the school district, school board has asked. And so the 11th to me kind of didn't feel arbitrary. It felt an ask for them to get things in order. Do you feel going beyond the 11th or this date is still arbitrary? Does that change your thinking at all?
No, it doesn't. I second it so that we can have discussion and have a vote. I think certainly the projections are that by mid-February, we hope to see 80% sort of immunity within the community. So that would be sometime after the 14th. I think we do need to respect the time for key partners to implement changes. So the idea that people think this can just go away, we've heard from those partners that it can't, that they do need time to get their teachers prepared, because there are teachers who do not want this to go away. I've heard from them. There are parents who do not want this to go away for their kids. I've heard from them. So there's a lot of people who've voiced various opinions. So to me, seeing the data for two more weeks is certainly more favorable, but it doesn't necessarily change my opinion that I want to see us actually achieve those levels rather than project that we will be there at a certain date. So, but again, I appreciate all the things you've said. There are so many nuances to all of this. And I feel like, again, keeping the mask for a few more weeks and then removing it when we really feel confident is much more intelligent than just getting rid of it now and hoping that we achieve those levels.
Thanks for that clarification for me.
The only other thing I would offer, I know Harriet talked about calling a special meeting. We do have a Board of Health meeting that would occur already between now and the date that she chose. So I don't know that we need to call a special meeting to review and make changes, but we already have an opportunity to do that. So we could just have an item if necessary to review if this passes.
That's a really good point, and I would accept that as a friendly amendment, Wayne.
What is a friendly? I didn't hear a motion
the
for a friendly amendment.
Is that if we need to make a change, it would and relook at the data, it would be at our regularly scheduled board meeting, not a special meeting a week from today.
Okay, Kimberly, did you get that, please?
Yeah,
because you're going to need to read this all back to us. And so you're sticking with, I just need to make sure so many dates were thrown out there. You are doing the 18th, is that right?
If somebody made an amendment, I'd have to decide how to vote on the amendment. But right now I'm sticking with the 18th.
And this is to rescind the whole order, right? So that we will be treating everyone the same, the schools
right.
And everyone the same. That's very important.
Right.
So that Absolutely. We can send that with the schools as well.
This is all mask mandates that are under our control.
Well, we do have a motion. We do have a second. Kimberly, would you please read that for me?
Okay, sorry. I was writing, trying to figure out how to get all this in. So there's a motion on the table, a motion to rescind all mask mandates in Jefferson County on February 18th, 2022, following data updates provided at the regularly scheduled Board of Health meeting on February 15th. Does that sound correct?
That covers it. Yep.
Yes. Okay, we have a motion. We have a second.
Dawn.
Oh, Dawn.
Dr. Comstock.
Sorry, you flipped on my screen. You went a different place.
No problem. Just real quickly, a very small point of clarification.
Okay.
Per Harriet's comment, JCPH does not have the authority to end all mask mandates. There are still federal mandates and some other mandates. So it would be to end JCPH 021-006. So
you know what? Thank you. That is a good clarification. And we do need to make sure that that is written into the order. Thank you. Good clarification, because we have no authority to remove the state or federal. But this is the one everybody's talking about. Just so you all know, we're rescinding 006. So everybody's good. Okay. We do have a motion. We have a second. We have it before us. Lindsay, may I get you to do a roll call, please, for a roll call vote?
Sure. Harriet Hall?
Aye.
Kimberly Kropik?
Aye.
Blaine Draeger?
Aye.
And Sherry Johns?
Aye.
Thanks.
The motion passes unanimously. Members, you've done a great job. Do you realize you just did this in that 2 hours? Because I knew y'all could do it. Shortest board meeting we've had in a very long time, I gotta say. And I thank you for all of your work. Are there further comments that anyone would like to make? Kimberly, you have your hands up? Your hand up.
Thanks. I would just like to say that I think us accomplishing this in the timeline that you wanted to see is the direct result of all of us as you said, doing due diligence, but also in the extremely important work and communication of the data from Christine, Dr. Comstock, and other JCPH individuals who worked to bring that information to us. Whether that information was presented today on our call or provided to us via email in the links of the emails that you all so graciously provide in communication to us. So I just wanted to say thank you for helping me be prepared with my thinking and my questions.
And I do see that the attorney, Jefferson County attorney, has her hand up, Kim Sorrells.
Thank you.
Would you like to speak?
Yes, I have one point of clarification. So when I write the order to rescind this, I just want to make sure that the vote was to rescind it effective February 18th, and that that's going to happen unless this board takes a subsequent action at the normal board meeting that you have, the regularly scheduled board meeting, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. And at that time, then we would have to take a vote and a motion to do those changes or whatever. Is that correct, Ms. Sorrells?
Yes, that's what
okay.
I'm saying. We're
sending
it effective 2/18, but this board would have to take a vote and separate action to change that. Or if you wanted, if something happened and you wanted to modify to extend it further, then that would be a separate vote. That today's vote rescinds it effective February 18th.
That's correct.
Okay, good.
And I want to thank the public and everyone on all sides of this issue. It's a very personal issue, and everyone has every right to feel whichever, you know, which direction that they're going. And sometimes it is compromise. Always it's compromise if you think about it. And we don't always get, you know, I would have loved for it to be, you know, the 11th. But I also know that that may not be reasonable for some of my colleagues. And I absolutely respect their decisions as well. They're a voting member. And I just appreciate all of the time. And you all need to know, it takes a lot of time to try and study all of this and meet with people and get the answers so that you think you can come to the very best place that you can. But at the end of the day, it's very, very important that this board, because there was a lot of hesitation, and I respect that, but at the end of the day, this board stepped out, and they did make their decision to rescind the entire order. And I want to thank them for that, because it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of work on our health department to continually bring all of these numbers and issues to us. And I appreciate all the work that everyone does. And I appreciate the public, whichever side you're on. And some of me love me and some of me I don't like me, but that's okay. We don't always have to agree, but we can be respectful and we can have great conversations. We will not always agree. I will tell you that straight up front, but I will always respect what other people's think. And the feelings that they share, because they have every right to do that. So I know some people aren't happy with the date that we picked, but we got this done. And that's very, very important. We're going to join our regional colleagues and our partners in moving forward. And we are going to find sustainability. And we're going to figure out with our health department how to continue working into more of an endemic phase. And we have the experts to be able to do that. So with that, anyone else have any comments? If not, we are going to adjourn. And I appreciate the board doing their due diligence and all the hard work getting it done by 3:10 p.m. Any more comments? All right, seeing none, I will adjourn this meeting at 3:10 p.m. Thank you.